JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's weekly Market Outlook webinar for the week September the 27th until October the 1st. I am Charalambos Pissouros, Head of Research here at JFD, and I will describe the most important economic releases and events on the financial agenda for the week ahead. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. We'll leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, we don't have any central bank meetings on this week's calendar, but we will get to hear from several central bankers, including Fed Chair Jerome Powell, ECB President Christine Lagarde, and Bank of England Governor Andrew Bailey. Therefore, it will be interesting to see whether we will get any new piece of information with regards to monetary policy. On top of that, market participants are likely to stay focused on developments surrounding the Evergrande saga as the firm missed a payment on offshore bonds last week and more payments are due this week. As for the data, the most important release may be Eurozone's preliminary CPIs for September. But let's take things from the beginning. Today, the first piece of news in the morning was that Germany's Social Democrats narrowly won Sunday's national election, claiming a clear mandate to lead the government for the first time since 2005. However, with neither major party securing a majority and also both reluctant to repeat their grand coalition, it may take weeks or even months before a government coalition is formed. Perhaps that's why the euro opened the week in a quiet mode. As for today's data, the only worth mentioning is the US durable goods orders for August. Headline orders are forecast to have rebounded 0.7% month over month after sliding 0.1%, but the core rate is expected to have declined to 0.5% month over month from 0.8%. Now, despite not having top-tier data on Monday's agenda, we will get to hear from ECB President Christine Lagarde ahead of the ECB's Forum on Central Banking, which starts tomorrow, and where we will also get speeches from Fed Chief Jerome Powell, Bank of England Governor Andrew Bailey, and Bank of Japan Governor Haruhiko Kuroda. Other policymakers are also scheduled to speak throughout the week, so we will pay extra attention to their remarks as they could provide extra clues and hints with regards to the future of monetary policy, of global monetary policy. For example, last week the Fed confirmed that quantitative easing tapering is likely to start this year, with investors hoping that this will happen as early as in November. Thus, remarks adding credence to that view may result in further dollar buying. In the UK, the Bank of England appeared more hawkish than expected, encouraging market participants to bring forth their rate hike expectations and, to be honest, helped the pound to rebound and recover some of its previous losses. Therefore, it would be interesting to see whether we will get any hints on when the first hike may take place. If I remember correctly, market participants are now pricing in an interest rate hike to take place around February next year. So anything pointing to a sooner timing may allow GBP traders to increase their long positions. With regards to the ECB, officials of this bank announced a moderately lower pace of in its pandemic emergency purchase program. But made it clear that this is not a tapering move and that when the PEP is over, they will they have all the other tools available. So we will look for any comments as to whether the ECB tends to compensate by buying more through other schemes like the asset purchase program called APP. As far as the Bank of Japan is concerned, there is no much to anticipate, as Japanese policymakers have been stuck with extra loose monetary policy, showing no intention to proceed with any changes anytime soon. Now, on Tuesday, besides speaking at the ECB's forum, Fed Chair Jerome Powell will testify before Congress on the central bank's policy response to the pandemic. He will speak before the Senate Banking Financial Services, he will speak before the Senate Banking Committee on Tuesday, while on Wednesday, he will present the same testimony before the House Financial Services Committee. As we already noted, we will be looking for clear clues as to whether November is a better choice for the Fed to start scaling back its quantitative easing purchases. And with Powell speaking several times this week, as well as various other officials scheduled to step up to the rostrum this week, the chances of getting some kind of new information may be decent. As for Tuesday's data, we have the Conference Board Consumer Confidence Index for September, which is expected to have risen to 114.5 from 113.8. Now, on Wednesday, the main event may be the leadership election of Japan's ruling Liberal Democratic Party, the winner of which will succeed Suga as a prime minister as well. However, he may not hold that position for long, as national elections will take place on or before November the 28th. Taro Kano appears to be the favorite, a candidate that supports spending package that focuses on boosting wages and growth, which under normal circumstances is something positive for Japanese, at least for Japanese equities, thereby negative for the safe haven yen. However, we don't expect Japanese markets to react massively on the outcome. Remember that in the days after Suga's announcement that he will step down, Japan's Nikkei 225 surged almost 12%, suggesting that investors have already cheered the prospect of better days with a new prime minister. Now, as for the rest of Wednesday's events, we do have Germany's retail sales for August and the US pending home sales for the same month. On Thursday, during the Asian session, Japan's preliminary industrial production and retail sales both for August are coming out. Industrial production is expected to have slid again, but at a slower pace than in July, while retail sales are forecast to have fallen 1% month over month after rising 2.4% the month before. China's official PMIs for September are also due to be released, but we only have a forecast for the manufacturing index, which is expected to have ticked up to 50.2 from 50.1. Even if the data come in stronger than expected, we believe that market participants will stay more focused on developments surrounding the Evergrande saga rather than on data revealing how the Chinese economy has already performed. Last week, the firm missed a payment on offshore bonds, with more payments due this week. We repeat that Evergrande has 30 days to settle the payments following their scheduled date, otherwise the bonds will default. So the default risks remain well on the table. And as we noted in the past, this may have chain reactions to the whole Chinese economy. Therefore, the risks this could weigh more on the broader market sentiment. Indeed, we saw appetite staying soft on Friday, while today in the Asian morning, China Shanghai Composite fell around 1%. Now, during the European session, Germany releases its preliminary inflation data for September. Both the CPI and HICP year-over-year rates are expected to have risen further to 4.2 and 3.8% from 3.9 and 3.4% respectively. This may raise speculation that Eurozone's headline rate may rise as well. From the UK and the US, we get the final GDP prints for the second quarter, but as it is the case most of the times, they are expected to confirm their preliminary or second, let's say, second estimates. Finally, on Friday, Asian time, Japan's Tarkan survey for the third quarter is due to be released, with the large manufacturers index expected to have ticked down to 13 from 14, but the large non-manufacturers index forecast to have risen to 3 from 1. The nation's employment report for August is also coming out. Now, during the EU session, we have Eurozone's preliminary CPIs for September. The headline CPI rate is expected to have risen to 3.3% year-over-year from 3%, still further above the ECB's target of 2%, while the HICP, excluding energy and food, is forecast to have inched up to 1.8% year-over-year from 1.6%. So, despite the headline rate moving further above the ECB's objective of 2%, underlying inflation, the rate excluding energy and food, is expected to stay below that target, something that may add more credence to the ECB's view that policy should stay accommodative despite the slowdown in PEP purchases. Now, later in the day, we have from the US, we have the personal income and spending numbers for August, as well as the core PCE index for the month. This is the Fed's favorite inflation metric. Expectations are for further increases, but we already get an idea of where US inflation is headed from the CPIs. So I don't believe that the core PCE index could prove to be a major market mover. The ISM non-manufacturing index for September is also on the agenda, and the forecast points to a small decline to 59.5 from 59.9. From Canada, we get the monthly GDP for July. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. I hope you have a great week, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again next Monday. If you are interested in more detailed and frequent analysis, you can find me on our YouTube channel from Tuesday to Friday at around 8 o'clock AM GMT. So goodbye and have a nice day.
JFT, just fair and direct.